Hi all, today's topic is Software Development Lifecycle. In other words, what is the lifecycle followed during software development? Everything we do in our day-to-day life has a lifecycle involved in it. Knowingly or unknowingly, we are following a lifecycle or a pattern. For example, we make tea or coffee every day morning to power our day. What are the steps for making tea? Boiling water, adding milk, adding tea powder, adding some sugar. These are some of the steps that everybody follows during tea making. The order in which the ingredients are added is the life cycle of tea making process. Let's see what are the possible life cycles one can follow here. Some people boil water first, add milk, add tea, then add sugar. The tea is ready. For some others, the order is to add milk and water together, bring it to boil, then add some tea and then sugar. Rest of them boil water, add tea, brew it well, then add some milk to the taste, and then add sugar. So we saw here the life cycle involves the steps, which is adding of water, milk, tea, powder for sure. The order in which you do it is based on your preference. If you are on a no sugar diet or a diabetic person, adding sugar becomes an optional step in this life cycle. But no matter what life cycle we follow, all of us aim for just one thing: a refreshing drink to get you started for the day. Similarly, when developing a software, there are a number of steps to develop a good quality, robust software. These steps have been identified and proven to work by experienced teams across the globe. Let's go through these seven inevitable steps with a software development lifecycle. Step number one is called planning. Planning is where stakeholders, business team, project managers, program managers, technical leads, everybody sit together and plan on what needs to be built. In simple terms, the scope of the application and the milestones by which the software should be ready. Step number two is analysis. Analysis is where business analyst on the project will analyze on the requirements and features that's expected out of this software in detail. Step number three is design. This is where the architects and technical team gets involved. They participate in deciding the architecture of the solution. Step number four is implementation. Finally, it is time to start developing. The development team gets on it and starts building the software. Step number five, testing. Testing, the software gets through a testing team cycle where they start finding defects or bugs. These defects and bugs get assigned back to the development team. They fix it and give it back for retest. This cycle continues until the software is ready for deployment. Step number six, acceptance. Once a good quality software is ready, the software is presented to the stakeholders for their approval. If they are happy with it, that means it's a go signal. The software can be deployed for being used by the end customers. Step number seven, and the last one after deployment, is called the maintenance phase. This is where the deployment team and the operations team make sure that the softwares are running without bugs and always up and running in the environment. So these are the seven steps that we saw involved in software development lifecycle. Now we know there are seven steps involved in SDLC. That's the short form for software development lifecycle. Now we'll say SDLC in short. Now let's play around with these steps a bit. Just like our tea making example, the professionals around the world experimented by tweaking these life cycles a bit here, a bit there. They changed the order of these steps, the frequency of these steps, the duration of each of these steps, and guess what? The results were amazing. So let's see what are the proven and improved methods available in the market today that are up for grabs by the IT industry today. Among several methods available, the most popular ones are Waterfall, Agile, and DevOps. And these are the three methodologies that we will be focusing in today's discussion. Waterfall methodology. This is pretty much similar to the SDLC diagram we saw in the beginning. Waterfall model was built on one step at a time. That is, the project team will religiously follow each step and the order of execution. And only when a step is thoroughly completed that they would go on to the next step. Here, a thorough approach was followed, which made this methodology sequential in nature. That would mean a project team would start with requirement analysis, which was nothing but the planning phase of an SDLC. After the requirement analysis is done, the scope is determined, what needs to be built is decided, it enters into the design phase. From design, only when the design, the technical document is completed, it goes into the implementation phase. Here, the developers complete the entire design implementation, and when they are ready, it goes into testing. Testers sit and test the whole application that was developed, and only when they are happy, it goes into the maintenance phase. So here you can see a sequential approach being followed in waterfall methodology. Agile methodology. In this approach, you can see we have multiple cycles, which is kind of similar to the steps in the Sdlc lifecycle, and each cycle is doing the same steps again and again. This is Agile, where they do not believe in developing a software sequentially. That's what we saw for waterfall model. But they feel developing small portions of the application through several iterations, when with more frequent demos to the stakeholder, there are better chances of building a high quality software. So in a typical Agile world, a business analyst and a stakeholder identifies one or more features that are required for the application as part of the discovery step. Then this feature alone is designed by the technical teams and developed and then tested. This power portion, that is a discovery, design, development, and test, is the life cycle followed in an Agile environment, which is, in a nutshell, similar to the basic Sdlc, but they have customized it to their convenience. This feature that is developed is then showcased to the stakeholders for their approval. If they like what you built, you enter into the next cycle. Next cycle is nothing but pretty much a similar one, but this time you are developing another new feature. So in every cycle, you are incrementally building small chunks of the software, and at every stage, you're validating the correctness of the software built from the stakeholders, thus minimizing the chances of going wrong. Now let's compare waterfall methodology and agile methodology with a very childish example. Let's take a project to build a website, say a search engine. Team number one builds the search engine using waterfall model. Going back to our previous slide and following through the steps, you can see that for building the search engine, this team would follow requirement analysis. Then they would sit and design, they would implement it, they would test it. In none of these phases, they're going back ever to the stakeholders to validate what they're doing is right or not. They are focusing on the delivery and on the requirements they have received at the tail end of the waterfall. At the end of the testing phase, finally, when they deliver the product, maybe it's a surprise or maybe it's a shock for the client. We never know. Let's say this was developed by a 19-year-old girl. For her, everything is happy-go-lucky. She thinks the search engine would look really pretty if we had some pink and purple on it and maybe some balloons and butterflies on it, but the clients may not approve of that. But what you saw here in waterfall model was the client feedback was not taken until all of this life cycle was finished, which could have taken, say, 6 months, 7 months, or maybe a year. So an year-long hard work is wasted because the client did not approve of it. Now let's go and take the example of an agile methodology. The same project was given to an agile team. An agile team would go and just pick one feature from this entire search engine. For example, let's take they took the design of the UI screen first. In the first cycle, they are building the UI. The same 19-year-old, happy-go-lucky, decided to put purples and pinks and balloons and butterflies. But at the end of cycle one, this was demoed to the customer, and customer gets a shock right at the beginning. And they say, oh no, this is not what I want. But what is wasted here is just one cycle. What is wasted is the team's effort spent in that one single cycle, which is not more than 2 weeks, 3 weeks, or maybe 4 weeks, compared to the 1 year life cycle that was wasted in a waterfall methodology. So here the client could give them an immediate feedback that I don't want such bright colors. I prefer something more light and subtle. This feedback is taken by the team and they enter into the next cycle, and in the next cycle, they incorporate this client feedback. This is the power of agile methodology over waterfall cycle. Now let's move on to a hybrid of this agile methodology, which is called the DevOps. Usually the project teams, they build a set of features, and when they see that a good quality amount of software is ready for deployment, that is when they go to the production and release the software for use. It's not that at the end of every sprint in an agile cycle, a software gets released. So it's only after a couple of sprints or a few sprints when a good size of project is ready that we deliver. But DevOps does not believe in that because they believe in time to market. That is, this approach does not believe in waiting to the end product to be ready to be deployed. So if you see the DevOps diagram here, it's again very much similar to the basic Sdlc, or the Agile methodology, where there is planning involved, coding, testing, building. But what happens is that at the end of testing, they're immediately deciding to package the software and release into the environment and start operating and monitoring. This is usually seen in a very competitive environment. For example, there are Tableau, Power BI. These are the two reporting tools available in the market. They're always in the competition on who delivers or who brings in the next feature into the market first. So they have no time to waste, no time to wait. DevOps is similar to Agile, except for the difference being they release at the end of every cycle through a strategy called continuous integration and continuous delivery. So in a nutshell, after learning about waterfall methodology, Agile methodology, and DevOps, we could see here that we are not trying to prove one methodology is better than the other or the other one is lesser than the other, because that is not the criteria of comparison here at all. All these methodologies are useful based on what industry you are building the software for, what is the nature of your application, etc. In the Agile methodology, you can see there is a big picture of what the end application should look like, but it is not a definitive big picture. It is kind of experimenting, rethinking, refactoring, and continuously improving as the team enters each cycle of the Agile. Because in Agile world, the importance is given to give more flexibility to the stakeholders. So this approach is suitable for any software that does not pose a risk to life. It is okay to experiment. But we cannot, or rather may not, use Agile for a highly sensitive medical tool, for example, that can pose a risk to human life. Those tools built has to be built after thorough analysis, research, and understanding of each of the feature. So here, thoroughness at each stage is very important. So in such industries, waterfall methodology would be a better fit than Agile. Having said that, this proves that what methodology you choose for your software development is based on the nature of the application being built and on the convenience of the team involved in it. Hope you found today's session informative and interesting. See you in the next one. Bye for now.